are also have prevents charities from contacting their donors. The other also serious concern was the lack of advice from the regulators, and the advice available out there was confusing, and there was a significant lack of clarity around perhaps enforcement. For the 5 days, I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to help you with everything on that today, but we will look at the key issues around consent and contacting your donor. It's not new, it's still about balancing the rights of individuals to privacy with the rights of organisations, businesses as well as charities, to use that information for their legitimate interests. And it's all about getting that balance right. Especially if data protection hasn't been something you've given a lot of thought to in the past. But really, it's just an extension of the existing law, and those of you who have already got robust data protection procedures in place are not going to find that there's a huge change here. But for those of you who haven't really looked at this seriously, then this is going to be a sea change. On the slide there, you see some of the areas that are either new or changing. So data protection officers, in certain circumstances, you'll have to have one. Compulsory breach notification, that is new, although voluntary breach notification is always encouraged. Fines going up exponentially. The top fine at the moment is £500,000 for a data protection breach. There are higher fines for other breaches of other laws. That's going up to €20 million. So the regulators are taking data protection far more seriously. I think most charities are concerned about £500,000. So, you know, €20 million is really to get those Googles and Facebooks a bit more concerned. The right to erasure, that's not new. It's in current law, but it's now enshrined in the regulation. Privacy by design is not a new concept, but it's now enshrined in law, and that's about thinking about privacy when you introduce anything, any new systems, to have actually thought about what the impact is on individuals. Consent is going to come on to as a main focus of this talk. Wider geographic scope, European data protection law is going to catch everyone in the world. Now, anyone who is pressing information about EU systems, anyone who listened to the Queen's speech last week may have been forgiven for thinking, oh, you know, no mention of GDPR. She announced there will be a new law to protect personal data in this country. Well, that new law. Because of Brexit, there is going to be some sort of way of introducing GDPR and then having a second form of legislation that will replace it once we leave. How that will work is yet to be seen. But because of the requirements for any organisation that's working with European citizens, using information about European citizens to have equivalent protection in place, I do not believe that we will see any dilution in the law. So it may change its name, it may not be enforced from Brussels, but I would say to you, expect to see EU legislation enforced post-Brexit, or legislation on equal measures. So preparing for GDPR will have you prepared for what's happening post-Brexit. So the main consent, the only issue about consent, is there's been a lot of talk historically about explicit consent, implied consent, when you can rely on consent, opt in, opt out, silence. Now, what we can say is that any confusion about whether or not you do or do not have consent is going to be determined on the side of the individual. If there is doubt whether or not you have consent, then the old ways of, say, of being able to justify it by what you've done historically, they are going to go. Consent under GDPR is very specific, but I'm also going to say that consent is not the only justification for processing personal data. In order to process personal data, you have to collect the information fairly and lawfully. That means you have to comply with the law in collecting it, a bit circular. But what's fair means that they need to know what you're processing about them, they need to understand what you're doing with it, and you need to meet that requirement by serving a privacy notice. That is not new. That is what you have to do and there's no detriment to the individual. And those are the two things I'm going to be talking about today. There are many other conditions, assessment of the performance of the contract, in the vital interests of the individual, in the interests of national security, but they're not really relevant to fundraising. So, if you want to rely on the consent of an individual to process their personal data, the GDPR is a slightly higher threshold, it's a more robust test. First of all, you have to show that that consent is specific, is informed, and is freely given, so it must not be conditional on the service that you provide. You can't make consent to marketing a condition of receiving the service. It has to be unambiguous, and it must be given by some form of positive action. So, yes, an opt-in tick box, a signed form. It can be verbal, but one of the other requirements of GDPR is that you need to be able to demonstrate, you need to be accountable for your processing. So you need to be able to prove that you have that consent. So if you're relying on verbal consent, just think about how you've recorded that somewhere. So if questioned by the Information Commissioner, do you have, what positive action we give them, how can we prove that? Then, if it's verbal consent, you need to record it somewhere, perhaps who will claim it and when. If you have current good consents now, for the current legislation act, you are going to need to make sure that they are, that they meet slightly higher requirements for GDPR. So at the moment, that positive action isn't necessarily present in the data protection act requirements. So if you do not have opt-in, if you do not have signed forms, if you do not have clear evidence of opt-in consent, you need to be thinking about refreshing your consents so that they are robust enough to survive to next May. I don't think we've got time to go through the various fines that have been issued here, but data cleansing is in itself a risk. You cannot send unsolicited emails to organisations that have opted out in order to ask them, do they want to opt back in? So if you do not have opt-in consent from individuals, do not contact them by email for data cleansing. But you do need to do something to make sure that your systems are up to date, but I would flag as high risk anyone that you cannot, that you do not have opt-in consent for, and do not contact them by email unless you're sure
see in the Telegraph this morning, and I know repeated elsewhere since, with some care, please. But if there are any questions or worries, do get in touch with us. We will explain and clarify as needed. Thank you for that little plug. Very briefly, just to really round this up so that you have a chance for questions, get ready for GDPR. That's the key thing to do. It's not long. Somebody calculated how long it was in a conference I was doing the other day, something like 10 months or so. Two gentlemen sitting in the third row there, responsible for that one, and civil society. But 10 months is really not long to check you've got the consents you need to have in place from your supporters, from your donors. Read our guidance, use the checklist, use the IOS material, decide consent or legitimate interest. We believe consent is the thing you should do because it's safe, you can evidence it. That's not to say you won't have legitimate interest available to you, but just remember, if you haven't got somebody's consent, you can't use legitimate interest as a workaround to try and get to them. You have to be very careful about that. And of course, you know, email and text would not be covered, as was being said earlier. ICO guidance due soon, we hope. Watch this space. The code will be updated. And again, I think my mantra on this is it's all about helping to rebuild, restore, encourage, develop public trust and confidence, and confidence in everything that charities do and their reputation. And above all, it's about excellent fundraising.
Thank you, Chair. A couple of quick ones. Issues with that?
So there are two categories of personal data, under the current regime and under the GDPR. So this is not changed, it's not new. If you are collecting information, capacity in their vital interests, so that's life or death. For employment law purposes, that's unlikely to help you. And if the person has deliberately made the information public, but I think that's also a risky area, because if you're relying on legitimate interests for having the information in the first place, it's a bit grey what you can then go out and find out from the public area in order to add to that information. So I would be saying, if you are working in a charity where religious information is public, that's absolutely explicit opt-in consent would be my recommended best practice for you. I'm not saying that there aren't other alternatives, but they are going to be very high thresholds that you'll have to meet.
There's two questions on here specifically around what constitutes consent and the action that needs to be taken. So one is it acceptable by saying, by submitting this form, you give your consent? So if you're doing a donation, can you just have that as a thing and then telling people that actually the positive action is pressing submit? And similarly, does consent always have to be a tick box, or can it be an alternative way of indicating that consent? So please put your email address in here if you would like to be kept up to date with future fundraising communication, and the action is putting in your email address. Do those two things count as valid consent?
On that end, probably not, because whilst they might be the positive action question, do they need the freely given? If the only way to make a donation and give is to give your name and contact details and agree to direct marketing, how can you argue that's freely given? And I would say, if you really want to have those best practice, where people feel that they can only give to you if you then send them further marketing, I wouldn't suggest making a condition of submitting a form on the donation side. And similarly, if you make consent to marketing, a precondition of a service that is not freely given, if that consent is what you need to rely on to make your presence lawful, then all your use of that, if it subsequently turns out that the information commission says that wasn't freely given, therefore that wasn't lawful consent, all your use of that information is unlawful. So making consent a condition of your service is very, very, very risky. It's not impossible, but it's very risky. So in that case, I'll say you want to be taking consent as a separate, consent to marketing as a separate point. And you can, if you are, and you've got a data checkmark, allows you to obtain granular consent or have different conditions. So processing the information in order to process the donation, you use the information that's necessary. You use their name, you use their bank account, and you might send a thank you letter. Then you want a separate box that says, yes, I understand that you're going to use my information for marketing, opt in if it's electronic, or just a notice to say that you're going to use it for marketing unless they opt out for hard copy and telephone data.
Yes, but continues to donate, not having been asked, but just continues to donate to that charity. Can that charity acknowledge and thank them for those who gifts? There was a question about your plans around informing the public about the service and the expectations of how it will work and what they will receive in the plans that you've got around that.
Okay, well, just to take the second one first, I mean, it's out there now, it's getting coverage. There'll be stuff on our website. The Telegraph took it today. I'm sure there are others that will be taking it tomorrow, Thursday. It's been out on the radio. I've done any number of BBC radio stations down the line this morning talking about it. So the message is out there. I know those radio stations have all got phone-ins and the usual sort of mid-morning stuff that they do. So we're doing our best to get it out there. It will spread in that way. We've worked very closely with quite a number of charities, including Age UK, Alzheimer's, as obvious examples, Royal British Legion and other, who have amongst their service users a large number of people who might be vulnerable in some way, right, either self-defined or If somebody has signed up to FPS but they continue to donate and you want to say thank you, that will be all right, provided all you do is say thank you. Don't use it as an excuse to do more direct marketing, which they opted out from. So be very careful on that.
But if somebody registers on the FPS and then comes back to the charity at a later date and donates and then gives their consent,
then that's fine. Then the charity has a fresh opt-in consent, and that will override what's on FPS. The charity will be able to evidence that should they be challenged for whatever reason. That's fine, and the person wouldn't have to go back onto FPS to cancel their opt-out because the charity will hold a new, fresh consent.
Thank you. Joe first, and then we can keep it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a question often asked, and it's a perfectly reasonable, sensible question. Have a look at the guidance, work out what you want to do, and how you're doing it, and you know, make sure that you've rationalised for yourselves why you're taking a particular approach.
Do look at the guidance, following the ICL fundraising progress guidance should, as I said, mean that you are actually doing a little bit more necessarily than is absolutely required. And then, as I said, the club, come along to the website. We're not the only organisation out there that's doing the website. There's a lot of free information out there. There are other organisations like ours. We're trying to put some meat and bones, some practical sense around some of the guidance. We need visuals. So we've got lots of visuals as to how to work through certain problems. And over the next, over the next 12 months, leading into next May, we'll be a little bit late. We're going to look at each of the key areas and really put some practical advice out there. This month, we're looking at privacy impact assessment.